Next speaker up is Brandon Workentin. He's from Security Matters, and he's going to talk a bit more about what the CTFs that's here in place, and also in CTFs in general, challenging the next generation of ICA security professionals. So, Brandon, here you go.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Larry. I appreciate the opportunity to speak here. You'll notice there's actually two people on the title slide. That's because my colleague, Harry Thomas, actually was instrumental in creating the CTFs that we're going to talk about. His wife is about 2 weeks away from giving birth to their first child. And so in the interest of not getting divorced, he did not come to DEF CON. We are both ICA security engineers at Security Matters. We're a company that's focused on ICS security, and we're happy to be a part of the ICS Village this year. We're part of the CTF right next door. So what I'm going to talk today about is kind of 3 points. Why did we build the CTF? Some problems and solutions that we ran into as we were doing this, and especially this weekend, there were several. And some tips and tricks for that last part is really focused on how you can use a CTF to be more educational rather than just a contest. So the first question is, why build the CTF? I looked at the DEF CON webpage, the contest page, and there's 29 CTFs at DEF CON listed on their contest page this year. So why did we do another one? That's a lot. Well, the main reason is because ICS is a very specialized niche. And a lot of CTFs are focused on really that high-level person. So for example, the DARPA Cyber Grand Challenge that was at DEF CON a couple of years ago, that was focused on artificial intelligence, and you really needed to be an expert-level person in both AI and malware and all that in order to be successful at that or even to compete in it. The DEF CON official CTF or whatever they call it, that's the same thing. It's a contest to find the best at CTFs. And then there's niche ones like the social engineering capture the flag where ICS is not really talked about. So we wanted to create something that was really focused on ICS for one huge reason, some other reasons, but the huge reason is because there's this well-documented phenomenon that the talent shortage of ICS security professionals. This little tweet thing is from a couple of years ago now, but Dale Peterson runs ICS-focused security conference, and his guess was 5,000 ICS security professionals in the U.S., with most of those hidden away where we never hear from them. What this means is that it's a really small community. And so I always like to throw this one if I'm talking at a place that is not necessarily ICS security people, but maybe general IT security people. I like to point this out because it's a small community, you can get involved, you can meet people really easily, and it's just a great way to get involved. I personally have only been involved in the ICS stuff for about 5-6 years, and within a year I knew most, like a ton of people who gave talks at DEF CON and stuff on ICS security because it's such a small community. It's a really great community to become a part of. I've talked about ICS. One of the problems when you're talking about ICS security is industrial control system security. So there's lots of acronyms. If you come from an enterprise security background, I'm sure you deal with that in other ways. But we talk about IT and OT. So when I said IT security, that means your traditional like SQL injection attacks or password cracking, things that a hacker, a generic hacker might do. That there's some things that a security professional who comes from the IT world may not be able to get away with if they come to the OT world, such as some devices, if you scan them in the OT world, they will fall down and cry into a little ball. On the OT side, it's just a different skill set because they have different requirements. And there's other people here this week who are talking more about that, but I just wanted to point that out. There's some ICS-focused capture the flag stuff. Reed Whiteman is right outside. He does one at the S4 conference every January. There's some other ones, but there's not a whole lot of them. So we saw this, we saw a kind of a opening for something like this. So we built our capture the flag. We call it the Lights Out Hacking Challenge. At DEF CON, it's a little different because we're a part of the ICS Village Capture the Flag. So we have flags and all that kind of stuff that you get points for. In our other events where we do this, like this was from B-Sides Orlando in March, maybe. We call it the Lights Out Hacking Challenge, where the winner is the first person to turn out the lights in Gotham City. To turn out the lights in Gotham City. So that's Mike Mitchell was our first winner of the Lights Out Hacking Challenge. We'll hear from him at the end of this presentation. These are all people from college students in Florida. So we were very happy that they participated and won the first CTF we did. Now I'm going to go into like the second area of my talk, the problems with creating an ICS-focused CTF, just in case you want to. The first problem I'm going to talk about is the operating systems. When I did CTF at B-Sides several years ago with the Pros versus Joes, everything was virtualized because you're attacking and defending Linux and Windows boxes, that kind of thing. In the ICS world, we don't run, many times we don't run just your traditional Linux, Windows, Mac operating systems. We run proprietary operating systems that do a certain thing well, hopefully they do it well. But it's a different operating system. You can't just go use the same tools with them, and so virtualizing them can be much more difficult. So you kind of have to have some real world stuff. It makes it much better of a CTF, and that gets into the next problem, which is money. ICS devices can be super expensive. This was off the rack. I just Googled Siemens S7 device and took the first price I saw, $4,000. That's out of the range of somebody who wants to just build a CTF for their local makerspace or their local B-Sides or something like that. So that was the first problem that we had to overcome. And so we did that with our business credit card, because that can solve a lot of problems. We created our Lights Out CTF. Here's a picture of it, so we can look at something prettier than a credit card. We created this, and it has several different use cases. So one of them is CTFs. At B-Sides, here, we use it for CTFs. Another use case is for trainings. And B-Sides Las Vegas, just this week, my boss gave a one-day training on network security monitoring focused on industrial control systems. And this was a non-vendor-specific, using all open source tools, that kind of stuff, just as a public service type thing. It sounds kind of cheesy, but we want to give back to the community in that way. But then we also can take this to trade shows, we take the same things, we take it to a trade show, and we do demos for potential customers. And so by making it a business thing that we use for business, we were able to build this. Actually, I should say Cyberical. Do we see Cyberical? Oh, yeah. Don't quite see, and there it is. Cyberical built this, and they're an engineering firm based out of New Orleans who we contracted with to build Gotham City for us. And then we use it to drive that business use case, we're able to then also do things like those B-Sides trainings and capture the flags and that kind of thing. The next problem we get into is shipping. this is a big problem sometimes, like yesterday. I'll get into that in a minute. Shipping this can be kind of expensive. It costs a lot of money to ship a giant 150-pound box across the United States. We put it in a Pelican case. We have multiple Pelican cases with custom-made liners and all that kind of stuff to make the model fit. The model sits in the liners and stuff, and then we have a portable server rack that you can see outside or on the other side of the wall. We have the portable server rack that's in a Pelican case to try to minimize any damage that comes from shipping. Sometimes it's unsuccessful when FedEx loses a 150-pound giant black case. I don't know how they do that, but they did. And it ended up being a good thing because we were able to then make version 2.0 of our case. And we were able to switch out. We started with a Dell 1U server, which was fine, but it didn't handle the shipping very well. And we were able to switch to a Supermicro ruggedized box. We were able to put a new KVM in it that was more ruggedized. So we were able to kind of upgrade, learn some lessons, and take the insurance payout from FedEx and build a new box. So version 2.0 would be more more hardy as we shipped it. I'm sorry?
How many of those
$4,000
Siemens boxes were in that?
Great question. Come out and we'll show you. We have an Allen Bradley Micrologic PLC, a SEL, a Schweitzer Engineering RTAC, and a Schweitzer Relay doing them. Yeah, we insure it every time. So FedEx cut us a nice check. They actually found the box, but after they cut the check, and so they told us we could either send the check back or get our thing back. And we were like, well, we don't know what you did with it for the last 2 months, so we better just, it might have been sitting outside or whatever, who knows.
When you say
Micrologix is a brand name for Allen Bradley. Yeah, Allen Bradley, yeah. Shipping sometimes helps you, but it can cause problems. And then anytime you do something like this with technology, you're going to have technical difficulties and you're going to have user errors. And we've had both of those. When we went to our first CTF at B-Sides Orlando, we got there and our Wi-Fi router that we used for participants to get on was broken. And so luckily my boss is always prepared and he had his travel router with him. And so we were able to use that at the second, at that first CTF. We actually have another person who works in our company who's related to my boss, and I told her about that I was putting the Boy Scout slide up, and she said, oh no, he's a Coast Guard person. They're always prepared. I never knew that. Coast Guardian, I don't know whatever you call a Coast Guard person, he was in the Coast Guard. And so he's always prepared. Of course, then we went to our next event and he was not there and we didn't bother to buy a router. So that one was definitely user error on that one. So again, we have the business card and we have Amazon 2-hour delivery to the Denver hotel. So we were able to solve that problem by spending more of my CEO's money. And then we have this week, and I've talked to some of you about what happened yesterday and today. We came in yesterday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon to set up our CTF like we planned to, and that right there is where that Supermicro 1U ruggedized computer is supposed to be. This was after we started looking at it for a while. That is where it is, that's where its RAM is, and that's where its hard drive is. It was shattered. You can see the metal welds that came apart from FedEx shipping our box to us that we found out yesterday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon that it was totally broken. So
if you're going to have that happen somewhere, this is the place to have those kind of issues. Because my boss did a training at B-Sides, and he had somebody he trained there who he talked to a little bit, and this guy was going to come test out our CTF for us, run through all the flags, make sure everything was working. Wonderful. Instead, he showed up with three of his friends, and this guy is a hardware, like, genius. The guy, I think the guy in the blue shirt that you can kind of see in the back, is apparently a Ubuntu genius. And they, with my boss, they went to Fry's. They bought RAM, motherboard, everything. They built a server for us last night, which is why we were able to do the CTF this morning. We got everything networked and working, all the VMs on it, at about 9:45 this morning for the 10 o'clock CTF, after working late into the night last night. And honestly, it would not have happened without these random people from DEF CON who we never met. This guy, Fry's, did not want to sell my boss the two 32 gigabyte RAM sticks that we needed for it, because they were the only two they had in the store and the only two that would work with that motherboard. And so one per limit. So he put one on his own credit card for us so we could buy that and do it. I mean, that this community is phenomenal. So, but everything's working now. So now we're into it. We actually have a CTF going. So one of the problems you have with a CTF is having to protect the devices. So what we did was we enumerated all the attack paths that we might have. We determined which ones provided too much access to the players, and then we limited the risk from those attack paths. And we did that in a couple ways. The easiest way, maybe not the most effective, is to make it out of scope. So like we said, don't take out the host hypervisor. We're not in the business of defending hypervisors. So that's out of scope for the contest. Most people are pretty cool, except for the guy who was messing with everybody's DHCP server earlier this morning. But most people are pretty cool in this kind of thing, and so they respect that kind of thing. The other thing we did is we made the attack vector too difficult to compromise. So for example, we have an admin panel that might have a 30-plus character randomized password, because in a two-day CTF, realistically, nobody's going to crack that in a CTF. So even though we say nothing is unhackable, realistically for the CTF, that's something that we don't have to worry about being compromised. I'm sorry? Yeah, the length. So 30 plus, I said. Yeah. Yeah, that's why I didn't say 27 or 36. all right. So with our Lights Out challenge, and the title of this talk is creating a CTF that teaches. And that is near to me. I used to be a teacher. I taught middle school and high school for several years. My boss does trainings all around the country, like you said. He likes to teach, like I said earlier, he likes to teach people. We wanted to do things that really drove the educational side of this, so that if we brought the CTF to somewhere like this, people are getting introduced to the ICS devices. So I'm going to throw a couple educational terms at you. So the first one is scaffolding. So just like you might imagine, when you're painting a building, the scaffolding builds you up so you can reach what you're doing. Scaffolding in education is providing supports that allow the students to be successful. So for instance, my colleague Harry, during the first CTF we did, he put out the tweet about our friend Krusty has taken up a new hobby, steganography. Here's a hint to somebody, or to the participants, let them know, hey, if I find a picture, maybe I should look into what the steganography thing is. So we give hints, we work with people to build them up. Another thing we do is guided questions. So we like to talk to the participants. What are they doing? Talk to them about what they're doing. Talk to them about where they're having problems. Especially, like I said, in Orlando when we had the college students, that was like we were in Nirvana with that one. We can ask them what worked so that they can kind of get reinforced. If you talk through what you've done, then that helps you remember it better, so they can, that helps them. Give them ideas for where to, what to read up on when we close for the night. We might talk to people about that. We've done that in the past. Kind of give the those guided questions to kind of give people hints on where they should be looking. Another thing, another kind of tactic is reinforcement. We can introduce skills early in the challenge, and then we can build on them or require more advanced use of those skills later in the challenge. So for example, if we have the password prison in our for something, and no, this is not one of our passwords. We might have that as at early in the CTF, and then later on we might change that password to something where they have to munge the password a little bit, and we can talk to them about how they can automate the process of changing out those characters, making very password variations on how to, so that as they use a skill, then they come back, learn a little bit more about that skill, and build on it later on. So that kind of reinforcing as you go on through the process. Another thing we've done is collect traffic captures. And honestly, this is partially selfish because we like to see the attacks that are going on because we're in the security business. But participants can see what they've done. And then this one's really big for me. When I did a CTF a few years ago where that was actually focused on this. This was the only thing they really focused on, was seeing artifacts of what you did. It's very helpful when you do an attack, what network artifacts are occurring in the PCAPs that the defender is then able to see. So that if you're on the red team side, you learn what you have. You might learn how to avoid those artifacts. And if you're on the blue team side, you can learn what kind of checks you might want to look for. And it also allows us to improve the CTF over time. The more data we have about what worked and what didn't, the better we can do, so that hopefully things improve over time. So I mentioned the guy from Orlando, Michael Mitchell was his name, the winner of the first, he was the one getting that challenge coin. He said, one of only two CTFs that I have ever participated in that were designed to teach participants rather than test them, which was awesome. That's what we were going for. The little time I had to compete in that CTF taught me far more than I was ever expecting. So he put this out on his blog after the fact. That was the best feedback we could get. Honestly, if somebody like Larry or Reed Whiteman next door, if they win our CTF, I think we might be doing something wrong, because our goal is to introduce people into the ICS world, not to just prove who the best ICS hackers are. So thank you. I'm just about out of time. My name is Brandon Workentin. My invisible colleague, Houdini, InfoSec Houdini. Like I said, I could not have done it without him. For this weekend, I could not have done it without the DEF CON community stepping up and helping us save that server that got destroyed by FedEx. Please go check out the ICS Village CTF, or if you don't want to do the CTF, check out the demos. There's like an airplane cockpit or something that I saw in there. I mean, it's insane what they have here at DEF CON now. Are there any questions? Yes, sir. That we do not have a Siemens device in our portion of the CTF. I do not know if any other groups, the way the ICS Village CTF is there's like three or four or five different people who all created parts of it. So the part that we did, we have the Allen Bradley device for Allen Bradley Micrologics PLC. And then we have a Schweitzer Engineering relay and Schweitzer Engineering RTAC. So the Schweitzer stuff is the blue box. If you look at our demo rack, the blue boxes are the Schweitzer stuff. They control the electricity part. The PLC, that's sitting out on the table because it fell out of the server rack. It controls the ping pong balls flipping up and down. Cool.
Event production, that might help you. Question. I'm a student and a student leader in a cybersecurity club. I run a CTF. I want to integrate some ICS stuff. We can't afford hardware stuff like you guys have. Are there any software or virtual machine alternatives for me?
Great question. He asked if there was any virtualized integrate things that he can do for like a college cybersecurity club. The first thing that pops into my head on something like that is called Cybati, C-Y-B-A-T-I. That's run by a professor from, I believe, DePaul University named Matt Llewellyn, who's a great guy. He's been at the Village before. I don't know if he's here today as well. It is the last time I downloaded it was probably a year and a half ago, and it was like 28 gigabytes or something like that. So it's a hefty VM. But because he has that educational background as well, he has a virtualized network with a bottle filling thing, so you can make it's a virtualized thing. You can see the little bottle going across the screen. He has reference material. The reason the VM is so big is because he has a lot of reference material built into that, so that it's all ready to go. And that you get it through a Google group, but Matt Llewellyn's Cybati is probably the top of the line virtualized thing I've ever seen.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, again.
So I'm thinking, so this Cybati you just mentioned emulates or simulates some PLC devices, right?
Yeah.
So in your experience, I'm thinking, how realistic is that in the real world? Because, I mean, there's a challenge in actually simulating PLCs because,
so for something like that in the virtualized environment, I think the biggest benefit is that it generates the traffic captures for you, so you're able to then see what is happening. So you're able to see, even though you don't have that real world experience of actually working with a real PLC, you're able to see the network traffic. Yes. Yeah. So you mentioned that CodeAssist, CodeAssist, has a Raspberry Pi version of their operating system. So you can get Kali has a Modbus module. I'm sorry. Velocio. Yeah. Yes, in the...
Yeah, you can get virtualized PLCs for ABB 800 XA also.
Yeah. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
So you mentioned it's really expensive to set up tests. You're trying to bring more people into the community. Are there a lot of people in the community now that are easy to access for like pen testing, active systems, doing red teams? Like, is that a pretty robust, easily accessible?
Like people who do that you want to talk to. It's a pretty small community, but I think it's a very accessible community. So there are people who do that, and there's people who do Red Team and that kind of thing. Who are the top company?
Well,
we are Blue Team. No, we're completely passive Blue Team. So. Red Seal is one.
Most of the people are here.
Talk to people over there. Yeah. Talk to people on the other side of the wall. Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much for your time. I hope you all have a good con.
Thank you.